Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this Pursue 7A Neuropathology. And we are streaming live from PGIMER Chandigarh via Kolkata. And this is the first of the series of lectures in neuropathology. And today we have with us Dr. Divya Agarwal. She is an MD, DNB, PDCC, neuropathology from PGI Chandigarh. She's very, very, very well-versed with neuropathology, and she has more than 35 publications in national and international journals, a lot of it in neuropathology. And she is going to talk today on pathological reactions in CNS, vascular and ischemic disorders. And before I ask Dr. Divya Agarwal to start, let me ask request every one of you to keep your mic muted. Please keep your camera off, and please do not share your screen. When you join in, you please press join in, and please don't press present. With that, let me request Dr. Divya Agarwal. Ma'am, please share your screen and start. Thank you so much.
Sure, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, we can see your screen. Just make it full screen, please. Thank you.
Right. Yeah. So, good evening, everyone. What I'll be talking today are the pathological reactions in CNS. And then I'll follow it up with a brief overview on the vascular and ischemic disorders of the CNS. So most of the images that I've taken in this presentation are from Broke books and a few from a few published articles, which are duly cited. And I would like to express my sincere gratitude to my teachers, Dr. BDR sir, Kirti ma'am, and Devajyoti sir, who have taught me whatever neuropathology I know of. So before we go on to the pathological reactions which occur in the CNS, we will get a brief overview of what exactly are the normal structures in the CNS, the various cell types, and then side by side, I'll be discussing the reactions. So first we talk about the neurons. Neurons comprise just around 5% of the gray matter cells, and but they have a very critical and relatively complicated function. So because of their complex cellular function, they have high metabolic demand for glucose, oxygen, blood supply. And so whenever the brain is devoid of blood supply, it is the neurons which are the most susceptible to cell injury. Now, the neurons give off two kinds of cell processes. We have the dendrites, which bring the electrochemical impulses to the neuronal cell body. And we have the axons, which are responsible for the efferent conduction away from the neuron cell body. Axons we usually stain using specialized silver stains like modified Bielchowski stains and Bodian silver stains. And depending on the number of neurites that a neuron gives off, that is the dendrites, we call them as unipolar, bipolar, or multipolar. And most of the neurons that we see in routine practice, at most of the sites, we have the multipolar kind of neurons. So here we have the different types of neurons that we can see at various sites in the brain. These right here are the pyramidal neurons in the cerebral cortex. And these are like large triangular kind of neurons. And here we have the granular neurons. So these are the relatively smaller sized neurons, again located in the cerebral cortex. These are also pyramidal neurons of the hippocampus. They are located in the CA areas, the cornuaminous areas, and they are also large pyramidal kind of neurons. And the other kinds of neurons in the hippocampus are seen in the dentate gyrus, where we see these relatively smaller rounded neurons, which are the granular neurons. And here we have the Betz cells. These are the upper motor neurons, and these are one of the largest neurons which are seen in the human body. And they are located, these are the upper motor neurons. Then we have these kind of flask-shaped neurons, the Purkinje cells, which are seen in the Purkinje cell layer of the cerebellum. And here again, these are the granular cells of the cerebellum in the granular cell layer. These are the lower motor neurons. So they are located in the anterior horn cells of the spinal cord. And these have very prominent Nissl substance. So Nissl substance is the endoplasmic reticulum, which we usually see in all the neurons, but Here we can see it as nice prominent staining, bluish purple kind of these granules which are present in the cytoplasm. And lastly, we have these dopaminergic neurons, which are deeply pigmented. They are pigmented because of the accumulation of neuromelanin. So we see this brown colored pigment here, which is neuromelanin. And they are seen at two places. One is the substantia nigra in the midbrain, and the second is the locus ceruleus in the tegmentum of pons. So these are those were the normal neurons. And what we need to know is what happens when there is sustained energy deprivation. So whenever there will be energy deprivation, neurons are the most susceptible to cell injury. So what we'll see is cell shrinkage, nuclear pycnosis, loss of nucleolar detail. So in a normal neuron, we saw that there is this nice prominent nucleolus. But in these ischemic neurons, we see that there is loss of the nucleolar detail and the loss of basophilic cytoplasmic staining, because there is loss of the endoplasmic reticulum, and hence that basophilic staining is gone. And we have these hyper eosinophilic neurons, which is why they are called as red neurons. So what we end up is this smaller kind of a triangular neuron with condensed nuclear chromatin, loss of nucleolus and cytoplasmic eosinophilia. Such neurons are best seen after around 18 to 24 hours of an ischemic injury, but you can start seeing them after around 8 to 12 hours of an injury on light microscopy. So what happens if there is a sublethal cell injury in the neuron? So that the neuron will try to avoid cell death, and it will try to reorganize the organelles to avoid initiating cell death. So that can result in what we call as chromatolysis. We have this central chromatolysis where only the peripheral Nissl's granules are preserved, and we have this peripheral chromatolysis where only the central endoplasmic reticulum can be visualized. But if cell injury continues to occur after this, then the neuron will eventually result in cell death. So now we talk about a few inclusions which can be seen in the neurons. We have the neurofibrillary tangles, which are these basophilic crystalline inclusions which fill the neuronal cell body, and they generally look like these flame shaped inclusions. So these can occur in Alzheimer's disease, and they are typically known to affect the CA1 and 2A hippocampus and the pyramidal neurons in the layers 3 and 5, 4 of the neocortex. Then we have these. So although they are not really neuronal inclusions, but it is kind of related to these. So these are actually neuritic plaques or amyloid plaques. These are extracellular accumulations of beta amyloid, and they deposit as a part of aging or Alzheimer's disease, more commonly in Alzheimer's disease. So in the center, we have this amyloid deposition, which is A-beta amyloid, the amyloid core, and this is surrounded by these dystrophic neurites. And if we do a Congo red stain, this region will be congophilic. And on A-beta amyloid IHC, this area will be positive. Then we have the granulovacular degeneration. So this is seen in the form of these small basophilic dots or granules, which are surrounded by a clear region or a cytoplasmic vacuole. And they're also seen in Alzheimer's. And these subnormal accumulations of these kind of basophilic structures are composed of abnormal proteins like tau protein, tibulin protein, and neurofilament protein. Then we have these Hirano bodies. So these are these oval to elongated, very brightly eosinophilic neuronal inclusions. They're also seen in the pyramidal neurons of the hippocampus in Alzheimer's disease. And these are composed of actin and alpha actinin. Then we have these Lewy bodies. So Lewy bodies are intracytoplasmic inclusions which have this kind of central eosinophilic structure with the surrounding paler region, and this gives them a targetoid appearance. They're composed of alpha synuclein, and they are seen in these pigmented neurons of the substantia nigra. So we have the substantia nigra compacta, and they can also be seen in the locus ceruleus. They are usually seen in idiopathic Parkinson's disease and the related disorders. Lastly, we have this very well circumscribed intracytoplasmic red cell-like body, which we can identify is present in the Purkinje neuron of the cerebellum, because we can see these granular cells also here. And these are pathognomic finding in rabies viral infections, and these are the Negri bodies. So that was all about the neurons. Next we come to the macroglial and the microglial cells. So macroglial cells are the oligodendrocytes, the astrocytes, and the ependymal cells. And the microglial cells are not actually glial in origin, but they're actually a part of the macrophage monocyte system, and they're derived from the hematopoietic lineage cells. So the normal macroglia include these oligodendrocytes, which have these round dark nuclei which with a slight perinuclear halo, and we have these astrocytes, which are kind of elongated cells with vesicular kind of chromatin. Now the cytoplasm of these glial cells merges with the background neuropil, and so it is not easily discernible when these are in the resting state. But when they become reactive, like we see these reactive astrocytes here, which are also known as gemistocytes, they develop this abundant moderate amount of eosinophilic cytoplasm, and they become distended with eccentrically placed nuclei. This is also a reactive astrocyte, which is more like a star-shaped cell, and the processes are star-shaped, which are better highlighted here on GFAP immunostain, which is the glial fibrillary acid protein immunostain, and these are also reactive astrocytes. Another form of reactive gliosis is this kind of pyloid gliosis. So this is usually seen adjacent to long, slow-growing tumors like pineal cysts or craniopharyngiomas. And what we have here is a very fibrillar form of reactive gliosis, where we see these dense, elongated astrocytic processes which are kind of packed together, and we have these Rosenthal fibers. So Rosenthal fibers are these large flame-shaped, densely eosinophilic structures, which are a part of gliotic reaction. Another type of reaction which can occur in the astrocytes are these Alzheimer's type 2 astrocytes. So they are enlarged cells with clear vesicular nuclei and a single tiny micronucleolus, and they are typically seen in states of hyperammonemia like hepatic encephalopathy. More commonly, they will be seen in the basal ganglia region. Then we have these oligodendrocytes. So oligodendrocytes are present both in the gray matter and the white matter. In the white matter, they will usually be seen in the form of these rows of cells with surrounding perinuclear halo. And in the gray matter, they will be usually seen one or two cells surrounding the neurons. And here we see this Luxol-fast blue stain, which stains the background myelin nicely in the white matter. About the reactions of the oligodendrocytes, this is a inactive old multiple sclerosis plaque. So it is very hypocellular. There's a marked reduction in the number of oligodendrocytes, and you can compare it with this normal white matter where there are multiple oligodendrocytes with this perinuclear halo. And here there's almost no myelin left and very little number of oligodendrocytes. And what we have here are oligodendrocytes which have these viral inclusions. So they have these eosinophilic inclusions, and they're slightly enlarged. And such inclusions can be seen in progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy, that is PMLE, and subacute sclerosing panencephalitis, as can be seen after measles, and a bunch of other viral encephalitis. Then we come to the microglial cells. So the microglial cells have thin, elongated hyperchromatic nuclei, like we can see here, and their cytoplasm merges imperceptibly with the background neuropil. They're very rarely identified in the normal structures, because in the resting state, they're not very easy to identify. But when they become reactive, they can form these microglial nodules. So microglial nodules are usually an accumulation of microglia and a few astrocytes around the central focus of injury, like a virally infected neuron can be surrounded by these microglial nodules, or there can be neuronophagia. So here we see this dying neuron, and this is surrounded by these clusters of microglial cells. Then we come to the choroid plexus. So we've discussed about all the cells that can be present, like the neurons, microglial cells, macroglial cells, and everything. This now we come to the choroid plexus. Choroid plexus is this tufted kind of aggregates of vascular channels, which are lined by a single layer of choroidal epithelium. And this contains large pink cells, which have this cobblestone kind of appearance. Their function, we all know, is to secrete CSF. And the choroid plexus extends from its entry zone into the lateral ventricle. And here it transitions from the ependymal lining. So this is the ependymal lining. And we can see here that it is very different from this choroid plexus lining. So the ependymal lining has a single layer of cuboidal to columnar glial cells, and they line the ventricular system. Often we can identify cilia at the surface of these ependymal cells. And an important point to note is that there is no basement membrane underneath these ependymal cells. Another point that we should know is that such kinds of calcifications are normally present in the choroid plexus. So just the presence of calcification does not mean that we are dealing with a choroid plexus papilloma or anything. It just means that you should just know that such kinds of calcification can be present in the normal choroid plexus. So these are a few reactions. So here we see almost complete loss of the ependymal lining, and there is underlying spongy changes, edema in the periventricular region, and this with a very busy kind of appearance. So there's a lot of inflammation going on, and this is basically ependymitis. Here what we see is this patchy loss of ependymal lining with inclusions in such cells which are present immediately under the ependyma. And these are actually CMV inclusions, and this is a case of CMV ependymitis. Then we come to the meningothelial cells. So meningothelial cells are scattered within the arachnoid membranes, and they're typically like polygonal to spindle shaped. They don't have very clearly defined cell borders, and they have moderate amount of eosinophilic cytoplasm and very bland appearing oval nuclei. They usually occur in small clusters, and they can be heaped up like we see them here. And lastly, we have the melanocytes. So there can be few scattered, infrequently present melanocytes, which are usually dispersed singly, and they are in the highest density over the ventral brainstem meninges. And they're highly pigmented, and they basically contain melanin. So they are responsible for all those tumors like the melanocytomas and melanocytosis, which are seen in the, which are basically dural-based tumors. So this was all about the individual cells, and we will now discuss that how these cells are organized in various areas of the brain. So we have the cerebral cortex, the hippocampus, brainstem, cerebellum, and these are the areas that we usually examine during autopsy as a part of the standard sections. So this is how the cerebral cortex looks like. We have the six layers of the gray matter, and then comes the white matter. So in the gray matter, we have the outermost molecular layer, which is the least cellular. Then we have the external granular layer. So this is rich in those small granular neurons that we saw in the beginning. The next is the external pyramidal layer. So this is composed of those large pyramidal neurons and occasional interspersed granular neurons. And that is why on a lower part, it will appear slightly hypocellular as compared to the outer granular layer. Then we have the inner granular layer, the inner pyramidal layer, and lastly we have the multiform layer, where we'll see a mixture of these neuronal types. Then comes the white matter, where we like we saw already, there'll be rows of these oligodendrocytes, and there will be these linear arrays of axons, which can be better highlighted on the silver stains. Plus we can see these astrocytes, and an occasional microglial cell can also be seen. Next, we have the hippocampus. So in the hippocampus, we have these four CA areas, or the common cornuaminous areas. And we have the CA1, 2, 3, and then the CA4 area. These CA areas contain the pyramidal neurons of the hippocampus, they have certain predilections for certain disorders. Like the CA1 area, also known as the Sommer sector, is highly susceptible to damage because of hypoxia, toxins, their seizures, and is also involved in neurodegenerative disorders. Then we have this dentate gyrus, which gives the seahorse shape to the hippocampus, and this is how we usually end up identifying that this is the hippocampal region. And this is this dentate gyrus contains a very narrow, densely populated band of granular neurons. The most of the white matter tracts which emerge from the hippocampus are present in the alveus, and so the hippocampal formation is composed of the hippocampus proper, the dentate gyrus, and the subiculum. So the CA1 area then continues into the subiculum. And we have the cerebellum. So cerebellum has this white matter tract which is present in between, in the center of the cerebellar folia. And we have three layers: the molecular layer, which is the least cellular; the Purkinje cell layer, where we have those Purkinje neurons that we saw in the beginning, the large flask-shaped neurons; and we have the granular cell layer, which has the tiny granular cells. Then we have the brainstem. So the brainstem has three parts: midbrain, pons, and medulla. Midbrain is identified by the presence of this row of substantia nigral neurons, which are pigmented. They will have neuromelanin within them, and this forms the substantia nigra compacta. These are the dopaminergic neurons basically. Pons is best identified by the presence of these decussating fibers. So we have the pontine white matter tracts, which are decussating with these pontine nuclei. And the medulla is best identified by the presence of this inferior olivary nucleus, which is kind of this undulating row of ribbon of gray matter, which is composed of large pyramidal type neurons. This is the pituitary gland. So pituitary is composed of the anterior pituitary and the posterior pituitary and the pars intermedia. So the anterior pituitary has tightly packed acini, which are composed of acidophils, basophils, and the chromophobes, and they are separated by thin fibrovascular septae, fibrovascular stroma. And this is the posterior pituitary or the neurohypophysis, which is basically formed of the neuronal processes. The cell bodies of these neuronal processes lie in the hypothalamus, and this is the posterior pituitary. Just a single slide to show the normal structure of the spinal cord. So we have the H-shaped gray matter, we have the anterior horn, the posterior horn, and the intermedial lateral column. So this is the lateral horn, which is seen in at the thoracic and the sacral levels. And this is a section at the thoracic level. We see this lateral horn. And we have the remaining part at the outer aspect is the white matter, like we see it here. All this is the white matter. And the anterior spinal artery, which descends along the anterior part. And coming to changes which can occur in the brain normally with aging. So the most common one that we commonly encounter is the corpora myelacea. These are spherical basophilic kind of inclusions which are brightly PAS positive. And they are composed of polyglucosan bodies. They have a highest density around the blood vessels in the subpile region and just below the ventricular lining. We can also see perivascular mineralization with aging. So this was about the normal structures, their organization in various anatomical regions, and the few reactions that we can encounter. Next, we come to the vascular disorders, and mostly we'll be talking about infarcts and a bit about intracerebral hemorrhages. So before we go further to the disorders, we need to know the normal blood supply of the brain. We have the large arteries of the brain, and we have the leptomeningeal and the pial arteries. So So the large arteries of the brain have actually two pairs of large arteries. We have the anterior blood flow system, which is supplied by the internal carotid artery, which supplies approximately 70% of the cerebral blood flow. And we have the posterior system. By the fusion of the two vertebral arteries, they form the basilar artery. And these two systems, the anterior and the posterior systems, they anastomose at the base of the brain with the help of the posterior communicating artery and the anterior leptomeningeal arteries. So they anastomose in the subarachnoid space over the surface of the brain, and they usually have these anastomoses are usually located at the periphery of the arterial trees. So they will be located at the distal branches, where the distal branches of the anterior and the middle cerebral artery and the middle and the posterior cerebral artery anastomose. So these form the watershed areas. And whenever there will be a deprivation of blood flow, like in arterial hypotension, it will be these areas which will be first affected by the deprivation in the blood supply. So this is a schematic diagram to show that these are the coronal slices, where we can see the different territories of various arteries. We have the anterior cerebral artery, which supplies the superior frontal gyrus, the medial and inferior surfaces of the frontal lobe, and the corpus callosum. It is important to note that whenever there is obstruction in one anterior cerebral artery, some amount of blood flow comes from the opposite ACA via the anterior communicating artery. It is because of this reason that infarcts of the anterior cerebral territory are much less common as compared to infarcts of the middle cerebral artery territory. The MCA territory supplies the lateral surfaces of the frontal and the parietal lobes, and the insula and the superior and middle temporal gyri. Then we have the posterior cerebral artery, which supplies the inferomedial surface of the occipital lobe and part of the aminous horn. Now, there are two mechanisms of neuronal cell death. One is selective neuronal necrosis and the other is pan necrosis. Selective neuronal necrosis will happen when there is necrosis which is just affecting the neurons but sparing the glia and sparing the background neuropil. But when all the tissue elements die, the neurons, the glia, and eventually the blood vessels, we call it pan necrosis. So selective neuronal necrosis occurs because these neurons are more vulnerable to cell death. So they are the most susceptible to hypoxic damage, and it is the neurons followed by the oligodendrocytes, the astrocytes, and lastly the endothelial cells in that order, which are as per their susceptibility to hypoxic damage. Also, it is important to know that selective neuronal necrosis is different from the selective vulnerability of neurons. So selective vulnerability means that whenever there will be global hypoxia, there are certain regions of brain whose neurons are more susceptible to hypoxic damage as compared to neurons in other areas. So the CA1 and 4 areas of the hippocampus, then the Purkinje neurons in the cerebellum, and neurons in the layers 3, 5, and 6 of the neocortex, in this order, they are the selective vulnerability of neurons to hypoxia. But selective neuronal necrosis is the one where we'll have just the damage to the neurons, but the other cell types will be spared. So here we see selective neuronal necrosis, where we see all these red neurons with sparing of the other glial cells. And here we see pan necrosis, where all the cellular elements and the neuropil, which is showing this kind of bubbly, spongy appearance, is noted. So before I move on to how infarcts look like, we should know the concept of penumbra. Now there are two thresholds of blood supply. One, there's one threshold if that below
that threshold, if the blood supply is less than that threshold, there will be an impairment of the electrophysiological impulses in the brain. And there is another threshold. Below that threshold, there will be irreversible damage in the brain cells. So the perfusion range between these two thresholds is known as penumbra, and the value is 15 to 18 ml of blood flow per 100 grams of brain weight. If the blood flow falls below this critical value, there will be irreversible damage to the brain tissue. And that is what results in, it's defined as an acute disturbance in brain function or a complete loss of brain function because of ischemia or hemorrhage. Now, infarcts are more commonly ischemic as compared to hemorrhagic, and depending on their age, they are classified as acute infarcts, subacute infarcts, or chronic old healed infarcts. So this is the concept of ischemic penumbra and how the gradient of tissue damage is different away from the ischemic core. So this is the ischemic core, and then there is the penumbra. Then there is this tissue which has less blood supply, so it is oligemic, and then there is completely normal blood supply here. So this penumbra is severely hypoperfused, and it is non-functional, but it is still viable. And if blood flow is resumed, then this area can be preserved. But if blood flow does not resume, eventually, this area will also be included into the ischemic core, and the ischemic core expands with time. So we see it here on this coronal section that this is the ischemic core. Then there is the penumbra region, which is slightly damaged, and then eventually comes the almost normal appearing brain tissue. So now we'll be discussing the various CT features, gross features, and microscopic features of various infarcts, the different ages of infarcts. So this right here is an acute infarct. Here we see this infarct occurring in the middle cerebral artery region and in the posterior cerebral artery territory. And when a recent infarct, when an acute infarct occurs, the first thing that appears is cytotoxic edema. So that results in brain swelling, and that brain swelling is seen on CT in the form of this hypodense regions. When you see a gross section of a very recent infarct, what it is felt as a softened area with edema. So we can see that this area is edematous because the gyri are fitting into each other like a jigsaw puzzle, and the sulci are barely visible as compared to this normal appearing sulci and gyri. There's a slight dusky discoloration of the gray brain matter, and the junction of the gray-white junction is blurred. With time, this area becomes more demarcated, well demarcated over the next 1 or 2 days, and it will look something like this. So it is a very well demarcated area. It is now that you can make out best the vascular territory of the infarct, and this area will be softened. So here we see this acute infarct in the lateral part of the medulla. There is a very sharp demarcation of the necrotic tissue, and it has kind of a geographical contour when we see on low par. When you see under the microscope, what you see are these red neurons in the initial phases, and here we can see this evidence of pan necrosis. The background neuropil is edematous. And after around 24 hours, the neutrophils begin to appear. So this is a section taken at day 2, where we see these neutrophils which are infiltrating into the infarcted area, and they're trying to phagocytose these neutrophils, which are seen as these eosinophilic ghosts of cells. As the infarct organizes, so this is how a subacute organizing infarct might look like. So the softening of the tissue increases because all the material that was holding up the brain tissue is now being phagocytosed by the macrophages, which eventually appear. And there can be laminar necrosis. So there will be separation of the superficial cortical layers from the underlying gray matter. This is a anterior cerebral artery territory infarct, and it is in the subacute or organizing stage. when we see microscopically, we find these sheets of foamy cells because they have now phagocytosed all the debris that was there to eat up. And if you see here, this is the edge of a subacute infarct, and you see these sheets of foamy macrophages with some capillary proliferation in the this region. So the capillaries are relatively spared, and eventually capillary proliferation also begins. So this is the 6CD68 immunostain, which shows that in the region of the infarct, you're having a lot of macrophages, and it is these macrophages which are responsible for the softening of the softened feel of the infarct. And at the periphery, you see at the edge of the infarct, there is some microglial activation. This is the NFP stain, which shows that within the region of the infarct, there is marked axonal loss. And at the non-infarcted edge, there is multiple axonal swellings which can be appreciated. So it is this finding which helps us to differentiate it from a demyelination process. In a demyelinating process, the involved area will have axonal sparing as compared to an infarct, which will involve even the axons. Lastly, we come to a old healed infarct. So this is again in the right MCA territory, where we see that the whole tissue has kind of lost, and there is a lot of cystic degeneration, and there is hydrocephalus X vacuo which has occurred. If you see a gross of an old infarct, you will see that there is complete loss of brain tissue with depression of the cortical surface, and a complete liquefaction necrosis of this area has occurred, and this is in the right frontal lobe. This is also a chronic infarct of the MCA territory. So this whole tissue has resulted in a large cystic infarct, and this is the insular region, the internal capsule, everything is lost. This is the hole mount section from the same. So what we see here is that the cystic cavity can contain what is known as the glial scar. So we can have a few remnant blood vessels and some strands of glial tissue to form the glial scar. At the periphery, occasional macrophages can be there. And at the edge of the infarct, we usually see this reactive gliosis with these gemistocytic astrocytes, which are proliferating. So this is a summary of how an infarct progresses over time. In the initial hour or so, small microvacuoles can become visible within the neurons because of the presence of swollen mitochondria. And this is followed by perineuronal vacuolation because of the swelling of astrocytic processes. Then the neuronal cytoplasm becomes used. The red neurons. After around 12 to 24 hours, the neutrophils begin to infiltrate the infarcted area, and this is followed by presence of macrophages after around 2 days. So these macrophages phagocytose the dead tissue, and they can even be present in the infarcted area for months. After around 5 days, very little neutrophils will remain, and the inflammatory process is dominated by macrophage infiltration. And the astrocytes begin to proliferate around the core of the infarct. After around a week, the astrocyte proliferation increases, the vessels begin to show endothelial hyperplasia, and neovascularization begins. And after around 2 weeks, it is just that you see sheets of foamy macrophages, which can persist for months to years. And eventually what is left is just a cavity, which is filled with clear fluid and lined by reactive astrocytes. So now, why is it important to identify the territory of the infarct? The territory of the infarct will help you to discern that you want to look at which vessels. Normally, if you see an infarct, you should examine all the vessels that you can examine. But suppose there is an infarct in the posterior circulation. So you should examine this area. This is the two vertebral arteries fusing to form the basilar artery. And here you see that this basilar artery shows a thick atheroma, which is occluding the lumen, and you should know which artery to examine, and then you should examine that artery both grossly and microscopically to discern the territory of the infarct. Next, we come to hypertensive cerebrovascular disease. So, hypertensive neuropathy is defined by the vascular and parenchymal complications which occur because of chronically high blood pressure. Chronicity is important in the definition here because changes which occur because of transient increases in neuropathy can happen because of spontaneous intracerebral hemorrhages. They can be seen in the form of lacunar infarcts or as reversible hypertensive encephalopathy. So spontaneous intracerebral hemorrhages most commonly involve the distribution of the lenticulostriate branches of the middle cerebral artery, and hence they affect the deep cerebral nuclei in more than half of the cases. This is followed by lobar, cerebellar and pontine hemorrhages. So here we see a large acute hypertensive bleed in the basal ganglia region, and here it is in the pontine region. And this is how a fresh hemorrhage usually looks like. There is collection of blood, which if it is large, it can displace the cerebral structure. So we see that there is a midline shift towards the left. The edges are irregular. We can see some petechial hemorrhages along the borders. And this bleed can expand rapidly. It can rupture into the ventricles. It can rupture into the subarachnoid space. So when you see a hematoma, you should look at the arteries in the parenchyma, and hypertension tends to involve the small arteries and arterioles, which are 50 to 200 microns in diameter. The typical change is hyaline atherosclerosis or arteriolosclerosis, which shows this homogeneous eosinophilic thickening of the blood vessel wall and with narrowing of the lumen. If it is a chronic acute or if it's a malignant hypertension, then we can see hyperplastic arteriolosclerosis, what we call as the onion skinning of the walls. So here we see the arteriosclerosis. We can also see these Charcot-Borchardt aneurysms. So here we see that there is an aneurysmal dilatation of the wall with this is a small hyalinized artery in the basal ganglia. And we can see that there is some evidence of previous microhemorrhages because we see these hemosiderin-laden macrophages present at the periphery of this vessel. So repetitive microhemorrhages will result in this kind of mineralization along the blood vessel because of iron pigment deposition. Hypertensive changes can also be seen in the form of lacunar infarcts. So why are they called lacunae? Is actually these are small ischemic infarcts which are by definition less than 1 centimeter in size. They appear initially as infarcts, and later they undergo liquefaction, necrosis and cavitation, and they will just be left behind with a fluid filled kind of lake or a lacuna. And they are predominantly located in the deep cerebral nuclei with a predilection for the putamen region. And here we see that this is a lacunar infarct with these small cavities which are present, and they are seen as areas of liquefactive necrosis surrounding these hyalinized blood vessels which are showing hypertensive changes. Another cause of intracerebral hemorrhage is cerebral amyloid angiopathy. So cerebral amyloid angiopathy or CAA is a form of vasculopathy, and it results because of deposition of A-beta amyloid within the walls of meningeal and cortical blood vessels. This usually will result in a lobar hemorrhage, which tends to be more superficial, and it usually involves a single cerebral lobe, most common being the occipital lobe. Since these are superficial blood vessels, the rupture of these can result in a secondary subarachnoid hemorrhage also. And to confirm that it is indeed a cerebral amyloid angiopathy, it often needs pathological confirmation because that is where you can demonstrate the amyloid. So here we see this amorphous eosinophilic deposit in the leptomeningeal vessel, which is positive for A-beta amyloid IHC, and this is the thioflavin S stain where these are seen as positive on immunofluorescence. If this amyloid ruptures and spreads into the adjacent parenchyma, it is known as dysphoric angiopathy. And if this vessel is associated with vasculitic or giant cell or granulomatous reaction, we use the term A-beta related angiitis or ABRA. So Intracerebral hemorrhages, we already saw, can occur because of hypertension, cerebral amyloid angiopathy, and a bunch of other causes like anticoagulant administration. They can occur in secondary to primary brain tumors or secondary brain tumors. So secondary brain tumors or metastatic tumors are the ones which are more likely to show hemorrhages as compared to primary tumors. And among the primary tumors, GBM is the most common, which is known to show intracerebral hemorrhages. So one point to note is that these tumor or neoplastic hemorrhages, when seen initially, will have a ring enhancement because of the tumor. But the non-neoplastic hemorrhages in the initial stages do not show ring enhancement. In the later stages, they can show ring enhancement that I'll discuss subsequently, but not in the initial stages. So that is one point which can help in differentiating the two on the initial head CTs. Then drugs like sympathomimetics, cocaine, heroin can result in hemorrhages, and we have the AV malformations and the aneurysms. So this is a typical aneurysm. An aneurysm is basically just a localized dilatation of the blood vessel, which occurs because the vessel wall has become weak and it has given way. So this is a berry aneurysm. It is like a small berry which is hung to this vessel, and it is a sac-like dilatation of an intracranial artery. So it is connected to the artery by this narrow neck, which is formed by a thin fibrous tissue with some interruption of the elastic lamina. And here we see that at this point there is weakening of the vessel wall. The media is thinned out. The most common site of berry aneurysms is the anterior circulation. So they occur at the major bifurcation points in the circle of Willis, the junction of the internal carotid with the posterior communicating artery, the bifurcation or trifurcation of the middle cerebral artery, and the junction of anterior cerebral with the anterior communicating arteries. Just about 10% of berry aneurysms occur in the vertebrobasilar territory, mainly here at the top of the basilar artery. Also, these aneurysms can sometimes be infected because of bacterial emboli. So bacterial emboli actually can lodge into small parenchymal arteries. They can weaken these arteries, they become fragile, and when they rupture, it can result in a cerebral bleed. So whenever we get a specimen of an evacuated clot or a hematoma in a surgical specimen, we should not just dismiss it by saying that yes, there is a hematoma or a clot has been confirmed. We should actually look at the entrapped blood vessels within that clot to look for any mycotic aneurysm or changes of blood hypertension or amyloid angiopathy within those vessels, so as to help in discerning the cause of the bleed. Among the vascular malformations, we have the arteriovenous malformations, cavernous hemangiomas, venous angiomas, and capillary telangiectasias. So this is a typical example of an arteriovenous malformation. It is a collection of vascular channels which have variable wall thickness and variable diameter, and they are typically embedded within abnormal gliotic brain tissue. And so here we see this very typical AVM, which most commonly these AVMs occur at the interface between the parenchyma and the ventricular or the subarachnoid space. There can be arterialization of these, and it is usually a mixture of arteries and veins and with intervening gliotic brain tissue. This is a cavernous hemangioma. So they're much less common than AVMs, and they are very spongy and hypervascular in appearance, and they have a variegated appearance. So they can be associated with some areas of fibrosis, there can be xanthomatous degeneration, and there can be some areas of calcification as well. And they are composed of dilated multiple thin-walled vascular channels with interspersed scattered calcification and evidence of some previous microhemorrhages, which can be seen in the form of this deposition of hemosiderin-laden macrophages, which can be seen here. So this is how a hemorrhagic this is how a hemorrhage evolves over time, an intracerebral hemorrhage. A very fresh hemorrhage is very sharply demarcated and there is a very limited spread of RBCs into the adjacent parenchyma. By day one, the rim of the immediate rim of the surrounding neurons and the glia, they begin to undergo necrosis and the surrounding edema increases. Neutrophils, like happened in an infarct, they begin to appear by day two, and these are followed by macrophages, which appear by day 3 to 7, and they start eating up all the debris. So around a day after the macrophages appear, we can actually demonstrate hemosiderin pigment within these macrophages by the help of Pearl stain. And a week later or so, astrocyte proliferation begins around the hematoma with simultaneous neovascularization. So it is at this time when if we do a CT scan, we can find ring enhancements even in a non-neoplastic brain because neovascularization has started. And microscopic edges of the infarct would usually show hemosiderin-laden macrophages at this stage with reactive astrocyte proliferation. Eventually, the clot resolves, and what is left is hemosiderin-laden macrophages. A cystic cavity which can be left with the periphery showing deposition of hemosiderin, which on gross can be seen as an orange-yellow margin, and peripheral astrocytic proliferation. So that was about the hemorrhages. Thank you for your very patient listening. Thank you.
Well, Dr. Divya, how it was very, very, very nicely presented. Is there any questions or queries regarding this? Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Oh, I thought I wasn't. No, I just wanted to ask if there's any questions. Anybody has to ask any questions? I think there are none. It was a very wonderful presentation, specifically, you know, looking into the general pathology part of central nervous system. It is very essential for everybody to understand that the vascular activity and its events, because in all other activities, these things become very important. Thank you, Dr. Divya, for a very wonderful presentation.
Thank you, sir.
And I think we'll see you next. When is your next class? The next week?
I think 6th or 27th, sir. The next class will be taken by Dr. Vikarn.
Dr. Vikarn, yeah, that's right. Yeah. Okay, thank you so much. Take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Bye-bye.